merchandising, firstly, a little bit about what it is, how it can help you. I guess my main point today that I wanted to bring was two things. One, a little bit of inspiration around what the rest of the world's doing, and hopefully be a little bit creatively inspiring for you just to think outside the box and think a little bit differently. What happens when we go into our stores day after day after day is we get what we call retail blindness. So we don't see things that everybody else sees when they come in for the first time. So it's really important every now and then to take a different perspective of our stores and to think differently. Think like the customer, walk through what the customer sees, and sometimes it's even good to go and visit other stores and try and remember what the first thing it is that you saw when you walked into a retail store. Yesterday you might have gone, let's just say you might have walked into Bunnings on the weekend. What was the first thing that hit you when you walked into Bunnings?
The trolley.
The trolleys. That's definitely one. So then when you go back into your store, you think, what's hitting me first off? Is it preventing me, like the trolleys, is it preventing me from having a free entrance into the store? So just think differently about your environments when you go back in there from your day-to-day experience when you live out your life in shopping land. And so things like that are, I guess, what I want to bring to you today, and how to think differently about the space that you're in. The other one is actually want to bring us right back from that to our space at the end of today and really think about our spaces and what we can do with them. So we're going to go right from the inspiration right to how am I going to apply that knowledge to my space today. So I'm going to take you on a bit of a journey, and it's going to be very far-fetched, but at the end hopefully we'll land where it's a little bit more comfortable for us. So over to what I've got for you today is visual merchandising can be viewed by the uninformed as the superficial touches made to a retail level to promote a product. So visual merchandising typically is seen as price points all around the store. It might be seen as a poster in a window. It might be seen to the everyday person, sometimes what we would consider as visual pollution. Posters everywhere, sale here, sale there. Basically, that's what most people would consider as visual merchandising. Some people would also consider that marketing. So the difference between visual merchandising and marketing is that marketing is the big banner. So marketing is the overarching banner. And so if you think about your spaces, you're in the space of a not-for-profit. So that's your overarching banner. Then your space comes down into an op shop. So you're an op shop within a not-for-profit. So thinking about marketing is the overarching banner. Visual merchandising is a channel within marketing. Within marketing, we've also got things like advertising, digital, TV, radio. So there's all these different channels that sit underneath marketing. Visual merchandising is one channel. Visual merchandising is focused purely on retail and how we help a customer go from an experience into making a purchase. But visual merchandising is far more than just being visual pollution, sale, discounts, all of that sort of thing. Visual merchandising is about encapsulating the sensory triggers, so I think about our five senses and what triggers us, that are outside the store as well as inside the store environment, and they help to satisfy a need or a desire, and they build a positive experience. So you think about when someone walks into your home. When we've got guests coming over, typically, I don't know if it's like this at your house, but this is my house, it is. We scramble around the house and we tidy everything up and we clean everything and we make sure it's presented for our guests. So our retail environment is similar, where we want to give people a pleasant experience. We don't want the shop to smell. We don't want rubbish anywhere. We clean up, we sweep out the leaves out the front. It's the same thing. So that all of those little nuances are added into making up the visual merchandising. Visual digital merchandising can also be as complex as an advertising campaign. Now, this is a window in London. Now, we would never see anything like this in Adelaide. So this is where I wanted just to give you inspiration about how far visual merchandising can go. So this is just a window, which is, you know, probably about this wide in the window, glass out the front, a couple of mannequins, but they've used the visual at the background to really help create that scene in the window. So when people are walking past this store, there is a very much, wow, what is that? And it creates attention to the window and to the store. And that's really the role of what our windows are. Our windows are there to capture attention and to drive traffic into the store. But visual merchandising is also about the lighting in store. Visual merchandising is also about the seating and how comfortable it is for people. It's about our flooring and what people walk on and is there a mat in the way. It's about our fitting rooms. It's about our carry bags when people walk out. It's about what we wear. So when we're serving people and interacting with people, are we presented well? Are we dressed appropriately? Are we comfortable? Do we have slogans on our t-shirts which might be offensive to people? All of that sort of thing comes into, not that you guys would do that, but broader sense, that's what visual merchandising is. It's all about thinking about the visual presentation of everything, from the floor to the ceiling, the lights, what we wear, how we smell. I worked on a program with OPSM. Most of you wear glasses. You know that when you're getting your eyes tested and when you're working with a dispenser, it's actually quite a very personal experience. They're right up in your face. Now, if I've eaten onions in my sandwich for lunch and then I'm coming and I'm talking to you and fitting your glasses, chances are you're going to know I've had onion for lunch. So part of that is about going back, what I worked with them on is stepping on the retail floor and thinking about the customer experience and thinking, right, what have I had for lunch? How do I smell? Do I need to spray deodorant? Do I need to put a chewing gum in my mouth? Do I need to just be considerate of others when I'm going through this process? So that comes under the visual merchandising fold because it's about what the customer experiences with in that store at the time. So I wanted to give you a couple of strategies from visual merchandising. So these sorts of things is typically what it's called, and I like to use these phrases, which is all about street seduction. So how do we entice and get people into our store, off of the street and into our store? In-store stickiness. So that's about actually getting people to stay. Once they're in your store, how do you get them to stay in there? The next one is the sensory experience. So that's thinking about the five senses. Hello, come to the front.
Touch, taste, smell, hearing, and one other thing that doesn't come immediately to mind. Sight.
Sight, yeah. So all of those things come under giving someone a pleasant experience when they're in your store. Mm-hmm. Product discovery. I use that word discovery because we know when we go to shops that we like to either, one, go straight into the store and get the product that I want, go to Bunnings, I want my watering can. I've been to Bunnings before. I know that watering cans are down here, right here they are. I want to be able to select a watering can. The other option is I want to be able to go and I feel like I want to browse today. I've got time up my hands, so I'm just going to have a wander through and I'm going to discover what is available to me.
That's where the trolley comes in.
That's where the trolley comes in. That's right. So there's a couple of ways of product discovery. There's how do I discover my product quickly and easily? How do I spend time browsing? And the other one that really brings it all together is the in-store experience. So that's the overall experience that we're giving our customers, right from the moment that they're outside the store to when they stepped in, to what they experienced to when they leave. That also then steps into a marketing channel, which which is all about word of mouth. What do people say about their experience at your store once they leave? Do they recommend it to their friends and family? Do they talk about what a pleasant experience it was? The other thing to add into here is that when people talk about going to a restaurant and they talk about their experience, what's some of the first thing that people talk about?
The staff were nice.
That's right. Everyone always says the staff and the service.
I'm probably worried more about the cost.
The cost, yep. So it's typically cost, quality of food, or the service. Sometimes it's, you know, I couldn't get a car park, and there's other little things, but typically they're the key things. But the most common one...
Noisy.
Is noisy. There's all of those other considerations. But 9 times out of 10, everyone will comment on the staff, and they'll say the staff were great. And so chances are that people are going to leave your stores saying, you've got to go there. Bob, well, he was so funny. You know, when he served me, he was really funny. He gave me a great experience. He's a laugh. You know, Bob will give you good service. So it's those sorts of things also that come into visual merchandising and the full in-store experience. So thinking a little bit more about street seduction, which is really about getting people from the street into our stores. So this is about windows stopping people in their tracks and compelling them to go inside to the store. It's pretty basic. However, it's actually a really hard thing to do. So the concept is basic. Getting someone from the outside to the inside, it is a very tricky thing to do. And that's why you'll see stores that we saw before in London have amazing windows. Some of those windows they take months and months to plan. They take military precision and they take a big investment. None of what you guys have today. So this is where it's about thinking outside the box, knowing what to aim for, and knowing what it is that you want to say in your window or what message you need to communicate, and then thinking about what tactical things are at my disposal to make that happen.
But the window aspect's only really good if it's a footpath past your shop more than a roadway.
Not necessarily.
As a motorist, technically, you shouldn't be looking. Windows,
yes,
for a start.
But we do.
We do, but like in our instance, we've also got a car park between the shop, and we've got a bit of a verge and then the road. So
yeah. You're
not really going to be stuffing too many people in their tracks to go inside in that environment.
Yes, but there's all the role that it plays is all about having presence and getting someone in by having a something enticing in that window. So if they're driving by and they say, see a big, massive 50% off sale sign, and they're in the mindset of, I want a discount, they may have been and seen that and remember to come back at the next time. They may, if there's nothing in the window, chances are they're not going to remember you and they'll keep on driving. So it's about having creating a presence as well. Hello. Welcome. We are up to part one, so you're okay. We'll get you up to speed. The other one is from the window perspective. It's about being seasonal and topical. So again, sale time, capitalize on all the stuff that's happening in the market. Everyone talks about mid-season sales. So that's the time to be on sale too, because everyone's in the sale mindset. Everyone talks about Mother's Day, Father's Day, Christmas, all the seasons that there are, jump on board, all of that stuff. When I say seasons also, think about the natural seasons, winter things. You're probably already doing that, dressing mannequins in scarves and all that sort of thing for winter. So it's those sorts of theatrics that really come to play in the window. Windows are a highly effective marketing method to communicate key messages, so that's what we're talking about, the 50% off time. Off sign, for example. You've got a craft store coming up. That's a key message that you want to promote, potentially redo if you don't have windows though, actually.
No, we don't, no.
But if you did have a window and you're thinking about promoting a key message like a craft store, you could potentially deck out your window, which is all about craft, like set up a scene of craft, hang up a big sign, craft sale or whatever, that sort of thing. So it's about theming it all and following the journey along. With retailers in the same markets working with similar merchandise,